Good morning. Welcome to worship this morning on this festive day. It is All Saints Day today, so that is always November 1st, and it's a Sunday this year, which makes it extra special. We celebrate all those who have died in the faith and are now with Jesus, especially those whom we loved and knew. And we also celebrate the fact that every single one of us is a saint because of Jesus' death on the cross. He made all of his baptized people saints. So you can go home and say, I'm Saint whoever, and it'll be true. So that's why this is such a wonderful day. We are also celebrating confirmation today for Jacob and Carter. They have lived a year of COVID and were not able to have confirmation in April when it was originally scheduled. So we're celebrating their confirmation of faith today, and it's a very special day for them and their families. I have a couple of extra announcements to make today. First of all, next Sunday after church, fellowship time will be a special celebration for Donna. A birthday, a very special birthday. I'll let her tell you which one it is if she wants. But her family is going to be having a celebration for her birthday next Sunday after church. Also, we'll be adding to our prayer list Bob Doring. That is Trish Hazen's stepfather, and he began cancer treatments this week. I wanted to just mention how we are doing Holy Communion right now during COVID. So you should have, if you are a baptized believer who does commune, you should have received a little communion kit by the front door, and you just keep it with you. And then during the time of communion in the service, we will go through the communion liturgy just as we always do, and then when it's time, I'll ask you to take those kits out and to commune, and you'll just, I'll say, take and eat, you'll take the bread out and have it in your pew, then I'll say, take and drink, and you'll have the wine. So it's all done from where you're seated. Anybody have any other announcements this morning? Okay, your church newsletters are on a table by the front door if you didn't get one of those. They're also available online. And I want to extend a very special welcome to all who will be worshiping with us online today. You are with us in spirit. So we will begin our worship today by dedicating the beautiful quilts and the kits that were made by the women of the word of this congregation and that are now going to be boxed up and sent around the world to those in need. This is a special time. We dedicate them every year, and because of COVID schedules, it needed to be earlier this year, so it's today. And so I would invite all of you to stand as you are able. And I'd like to ask the kids who want to come up here. So any kids that you want, come on up here. We're going to bless these school kits that are going to other kids all over the place, okay? So I'll just have you stand right so you can put your hands on them, okay? Very good. Okay? There's plenty of room. I'll get out of your way. Awesome. Okay. And I'll ask the congregation to put your hands on the quilts that are in front of you. Because what we're doing is we're sending our blessings and God's blessings to the people who are going to get these. And they might be people who live in Africa or Central America or all in Estonia, all over the world. And they're people who don't have enough school things to go to school with, or don't have towels and soap, or don't have warm blankets on their beds. And that's why we're sending them these things, okay? All right, let us pray. God of grace, over the clamor of the world's self-serving roar, you have made known to us people with profound needs, and by grace you have freed us to respond. We thank you, gracious God. With hours and hands, purse and purchase, needle and thread, you have provided us with a far-reaching channel to make our compassion tangible. We thank you, gracious God. Having reached the completion of our project, the kits and quilts arrayed before us have become gifts of hope and beauty. We thank you, gracious God. As we gather today, we pray your blessing upon these quilts and kits. and pray that they may be a blessing to those who receive them. May they be blessed to be a blessing, loving God. Stir in us your spirit and commit our lives to your mission of remedy for the desperate conditions which cry for such mercies as these. Give us courage, merciful God. Embolden us to advocate for greater justice, wider mercy, and persistent peace among the peoples of the world. Give us courage, merciful God. Guide us into simple, more open lives of faithful stewardship of the resources you've entrusted to us. Give us courage, merciful God. We pray for the work of Lutheran World Relief in our combined, faith-filled work to integrate these quilts and kits into a breadth of ministries, increasing the sustainability, dignity, and wholeness of those whose lives are now so challenged with such a deficit of each. Make us diligent in our labors, generous in our offerings, and earnest in our prayers. In the name of Jesus, our servant Lord, we pray. Amen. Okay, thank you so much for helping to bless those things. At this time, we will confess our sins before the Lord and receive his gift of forgiveness. In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. Amen. Almighty God, to whom all hearts are open, all desires known, and from whom no secrets are hid, cleanse the thoughts of our hearts by the inspiration of your Holy Spirit, that we may perfectly love you and worthily magnify your holy name, through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen. If we say we have no sin, we deceive ourselves, and the truth is not in us. But if we confess our sins, God, who is faithful and just, will forgive our sins and cleanse us from all unrighteousness. Most merciful God, we confess that we are in bondage to sin and cannot free ourselves. We have sinned against you in thought, word, and deed, by what we have done and by what we have left undone. We have not loved you with our whole heart. We have not loved our neighbors as ourselves. For the sake of your Son, Jesus Christ, have mercy on us, forgive us, renew us and lead us, so that we may delight in your will and walk in your ways, to the glory of your holy name. Amen. Almighty God, in his mercy, has given his Son to die for us, and for his sake, God forgives us all our sins. As a called and ordained minister of the Church of Christ, and by his authority, I therefore declare to you the entire forgiveness of all your sins, in the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. Amen. Please be seated. Our opening hymn is the traditional hymn for All Saints Day. It's For All the Saints. And I want to just point out the verses in your hymnal. So it's on page 422, you have to go back and forth. So if you just follow the verse numbers, you'll be fine. But 1 and 2 are on one side, 3, 4, and 5 on the other, and then 6 and 7 go back to the other side again. And our hymn after the sermon is a little bit that way as well. So just follow the verse numbers, and it will work out fine.
Thank you.
the grace of our Lord Jesus Christ, the love of God, and the communion of the Holy Spirit be with you all. The Lord be with you. Let us pray. Beloved God, in Christ you have drawn all your people into one holy communion. Grant that as we remember the saints who have gone before us, we are strengthened for lives of faithful service to you, so that the world will know your blessed presence. Bring us at last to the feast which has no end, where all will be one. Through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen. Please be seated.
The first lesson for this All Saints Sunday is from Revelations chapter 7, verses 9 through 17. After this I looked, and there was a great multitude that no one could count, from every nation, from all tribes and peoples and languages, standing before the throne and before the Lamb, robed in white, with palm branches in their hands. They cried out in a loud voice, saying, "Salvation belongs to our God, who is seated on the throne, and to the Lamb." And all the angels stood around the throne and around the elders and the four living creatures, and they fell on their faces before the throne and worshiped God, singing, "Amen. Blessing and glory and wisdom and thanksgiving and honor and power and might be to our God forever and ever. Amen." Then one of the elders addressed me, saying, "Who are these robed in white, and where have they come from?" I said to him, "Sir, you are the one that knows." Then he said to me, "These are they who have come out of the great ordeal. They have washed their robes and made them white in the blood of the Lamb. For this reason, they are before the throne of God and worship him day and night within his temple, and the one who is seated on the throne will shelter them. They will hunger no more and thirst no more. The sun will not strike them, nor any scorching heat. For the Lamb at the center of the throne will be their shepherd, and he will guide them to springs of the water of life, and God will wipe away every tear from their eyes. The word of the Lord. Thanks be to God. Please read responsively Psalm 149. Praise the Lord, sing to the Lord a new song, his praise in the assembly of the faithful. Let Israel be glad in its maker. Let the children of Zion rejoice in their king. Let them praise his name with dancing, making melody to him with tambourine and lyre. For the Lord takes pleasure in his people. He adorns the humble with victory. Let the faithful exult in glory. Let them sing for joy on their couches. Let the high praises of God be in their throats and two-edged swords in their hands, to execute vengeance on the nations and punishment on the peoples, to bind their kings with fetters and their nobles with chains of iron, to execute on them the judgment decreed. This is glory for all his faithful ones. Praise the Lord. The second lesson is from 1 John chapter 3, verses 1 through 3. See what love the Father has given us, that we should be called children of God, and that is what we are. The reason the world does not know us is that it did not know him. Beloved, we are God's children now. What we will be has not yet been revealed. What we do know is this: when he is revealed, we will be like him, for we will see him as he is. And all who have this hope in him purify themselves just as he is pure. The word of the Lord. Thanks be to God.
The Holy Gospel according to Matthew. When Jesus saw the crowds, he went up the mountain, and after he sat down, his disciples came to him. Then he began to speak and taught them, saying, "Blessed are the poor in spirit, for theirs is the kingdom of heaven. Blessed are those who mourn, for they will be comforted. Blessed are the meek, for they will inherit the earth. Blessed are those who hunger and thirst for righteousness, for they will be filled. Blessed are the merciful, for they will receive mercy. Blessed are the pure in heart, for they will see God. Blessed are the peacemakers, for they will be called children of God. Blessed are those who are persecuted for righteousness' sake, for theirs is the kingdom of heaven. Blessed are you when people revile you and persecute you and utter all kinds of evil against you falsely on my account. Rejoice and be glad, for your reward is great in heaven, for in the same way they persecuted the prophets who were before you." The Gospel of the Lord. Please be seated. A lot of you sitting out here today are parents and grandparents, aren't you? Or aunts and uncles. Most of you have some young people in your lives who are special to you. And I'll bet you spend time every day praying for them. I know I do. When they're young, we pray about things that we want them to learn and pray that they will be healthy and safe. When they get into school, we pray that they will do well and find good friends, and we pray about troubles that come up, maybe a bully on the playground or trouble with a class. When they're teenagers, we pray that they will hang out with friends who will be a good influence and that they'll be able to face all the temptations they're faced with. And we all know what we started praying for the day they got their driver's license and took off in the car, right? When they get a job or head away to school, we are still praying for their safety and that they will make good decisions and find their way in the world. We pray for the person they will one day marry. And when grandkids come along, we start all over again. And all of these prayers are good. These prayers are the easy ones, the ones that come naturally to us, because we love our kids and we want what's best for them in this world. But I also hope, along with these easy prayers, you are praying even more important prayers on behalf of your children, prayers that they will remain close to God as they go out into the world, prayers that they will have a personal relationship with Jesus that will be deep enough and strong enough to carry them through the hard times. I prayed these prayers over my children when they were little, and I still do today, now that they're grown. But I pray these prayers with fear and trembling. Why? Because even as I pray this, I know that by praying for God to be at work in their lives, I might be praying for bad circumstances to happen to them. Because sometimes that's the only way God can get through. Most often, faith is deepened and strengthened not when things are going our way and everything is great, but during times of trouble and hardship. That's when we realize that the only way we can make it is by giving it all to God and letting Him carry us through. That's exactly what we see at work in Jesus' sermon today. At first glance, it all seems backwards. Are you grieving? Are you poor? Are you hungry? Are you persecuted? Then you're being blessed. How can this be? It can be because God uses those circumstances to make you into the person He meant you to be. Have you ever noticed that it's in those most difficult times of life that people turn to God? When everything is going well, it's easy to ignore God working in our lives. But when we're faced with a pandemic that seems to take away all the things we care about, or the death of someone we love, or the loss of a job, or a cancer diagnosis, then we learn that we can't rely on ourselves, that God is the only source of strength and comfort and peace that we have. And so, the most important thing that we pray for ourselves and for those we love is that they will remember during the good times and the bad times, that they are beloved children of God, redeemed from sin and death and every evil by the death and resurrection of Jesus. We pray that they will take that assurance with them out into the world and into the midst of whatever difficult circumstances may come their way. That's what the parents of little Ruby Bridges did. Ruby was just 6 years old in 1960 when she was the first and only black student selected to attend the William France Elementary School in New Orleans after the Supreme Court had ordered the desegregation of schools. On the first day of school, four federal marshals escorted Ruby into the school. She spent all day in the principal's office with her mother while every single first grade parent pulled their children out of the school and most of the teachers resigned. One white teacher, Mrs. Henry, agreed to teach Ruby, and for the entire school year, Ruby was the only student in her class. Militant segregationists took to the streets in protest and riots erupted all over the city. Every morning, federal marshals drove Ruby to school and walked with her into the building, surrounded by angry mobs of white people screaming and shouting hateful insults at this six-year-old. Once someone shoved a small coffin containing a black doll into Ruby's face as she walked past. Her father was fired from his job, and her grandparents were thrown off the small Mississippi farm where they had been sharecroppers their entire lives. Mrs. Henry, Ruby's teacher, always watched from her window as she walked into the school each morning. One day when she arrived at her classroom, Mrs. Henry said she'd been surprised to see Ruby speaking to the crowds that surrounded her. "I saw your lips moving," she said to Ruby, "but I couldn't tell what you were saying. What did you say to that mob of people?" "I wasn't talking to them," little Ruby told her. "I was praying for them." When asked what she prayed, Ruby said, "I prayed, please be with me and with those people too. Forgive them because they don't know what they're doing." 6-year-old Ruby Bridges had a strength that came from outside herself, a hope and a comfort that even angry mobs of haters couldn't penetrate. Her parents were praying parents, and they had taught her to pray as well. And though I'm sure they prayed for her safety, they also prayed that God would be at work in her life and that His will would be done. And in the midst of circumstances that no parent would ever wish on their child, God brought much good. Ruby Bridges prayed the very prayer that Jesus prayed as He hung on the cross. "Father, forgive them, for they don't know what they're doing." Jesus prayed that prayer for me, and for you, and for Ruby, and for all those hate-filled people who screamed at her every day as she walked into her school. Jesus prayed that prayer for Jacob and Carter, who today will stand before God and this congregation and confess their faith in Him. Jesus' prayer was the absolution, the gift of forgiveness that was freely bestowed on you on the day of your baptism and is given again and again as you turn to God each day and once again ask Him to forgive you for Jesus' sake. That prayer is the shield that you and I and those we love carry with them into the world with all its dangers and troubles, knowing that we are never alone and that our Heavenly Father will carry us through and not just rescue us, but bless us. Amen. Our hymn is Born in Cry, which is number 732 in your red hymnal.
Thank you.
At this time, I would ask Mike Court, President of the Congregation, to come forward to present our candidates for confirmation.
Carter Otten and Jacob Kathman have been instructed in the Christian faith and desire to make public affirmation of their baptism.
Each of these young men was asked to write a faith statement which summarizes what they learned during their time of confirmation instruction and puts in their own personal way what their faith is, and now they're going to share those with you. So I'd ask Carter to come forward at this time.
The confirmation verse I chose comes from Philippians 4:13. I can do all things through him who strengthens me. In Paul's epistle to the church of Philippi, he shared how to live a Christian life. He always tried to be content as a Christian believer. Paul went through times of need and times of prosperity. He never complained if he was hungry or thirsty because he knew that whatever happened, God would always be with him. I chose this verse because I feel like Paul is explaining a wrestling match with life. Right when you're on your back at the point of being pinned, you have to have faith in getting off your back. Just like trying not to get pinned is like sinning. I am content with winning and losing, knowing I gave it my all and had God's strength to get me through it all. My opponent, Satan, is evil. He may score some points, but he will never win while God is watching over me. God the Father is the creator of everything. He watches over everyone and is in control over everything and everyone. God is my Father and Savior. God wakes me up every single day and helps me live a good life. Through God and through good and bad times, he is always there for everyone. My main responsibilities as a child of God is to spread the word of God, try not to sin, and to help other people at their worst and their best. Jesus came into this world to spread the word of God and to die for our sins. Jesus did this for us because he wanted our lives to be lived with joy, passion, and anything good. I know that my sins were forgiven when God gave his own son, Jesus Christ, to die on the cross and to be tortured with a thorn crown and nails through his hands and feet. To me, knowing my sins are forgiven means that God is always watching over me and will always forgive me for my sins. God wakes me up every day and is giving me a good life. He also is helping me through sports and this whole COVID-19 stuff. Everyone in my life, friends, family, pastors, and this congregation. The Holy Spirit is always with everyone in the church. The Holy Spirit is always helping people understand what God did for us. No matter what, God will always be with everyone.
My confirmation verse is Romans 1, verse 16. It says, "For I am not ashamed of the gospel. It is the power of God for salvation to everyone who has faith." The Apostle Paul was speaking to everyone who believes in God. He said, "Everyone who listens to the gospel will be saved." God is using Paul to deliver the message of him. I chose this verse because I think everyone should learn about God and listen to the good news he has for us. By listening to the gospel, you can hear what God says and wants us to do to be closer to him. This verse helps me understand that the gospel is God's word spoken to us. God wants us to believe that we are his children and we should pray to him and look up to him as if we were talking to our own parents. God the Father has guided me through life and shown me what's right and wrong. If I happen to stray from the path, he will help guide us back on it. My responsibility to God's creation is to spread his good word and help and pray for people in need. Jesus came into the world to die for our sins so we can go to heaven. He did this for me because by myself I cannot get to heaven. It makes me feel thankful that my sins are forgiven because I know I should be punished for them, but God is loving and kind and does not hold my sins against me. Jesus has opened the door for me to go to heaven by his death on the cross and dying for my sins. Jesus helps us to have stronger faith to resist the devil's temptations that try to trick you into wrongdoing. The Holy Spirit has helped me believe and understand what God wants me to know. When the disciples locked themselves in the room afraid of being persecuted for believing in God. The Holy Spirit came to them and gave them strength to go out and preach God's word to everybody without being afraid. The Holy Spirit comes through my parents and Pastor Leah to teach me about God. The Holy Spirit has given everyone in the strength to pray and believe in God.
Let us pray. Merciful Father, we give you thanks for the grace and mercy you have bestowed upon your faithful people, who throughout the centuries have stood firm in the faith. We pray that through your Holy Spirit, these confirmands may be found faithful on the day of our Lord, Jesus Christ. In the presence of this congregation and in the sight of God, I now ask you to profess your faith in Christ Jesus, reject sin, and confess the faith of the church, the faith in which we baptize. Do you renounce the devil and all the spiritual forces of evil that contend against God and his faithful servants? Do you renounce the influence and power of this world that are contrary to God's word and will? Do you renounce the sin within your own heart, mind, and flesh, and call upon the Lord to deliver you from evil? I would invite the congregation to stand and join Carter and Jacob in confessing our faith. Do you believe in God the Father? I believe in God the Father Almighty, creator of heaven and earth. Do you believe in Jesus Christ, the Son of God? I believe in Jesus Christ, his only Son, our Lord. He was conceived by the power of the Holy Spirit and born of the Virgin Mary. He suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, died, and was buried. He descended into hell. On the third day, he rose again. He ascended into heaven and is seated at the right hand of the Father. He will come again to judge the living and the dead. Do you believe in God, the Holy Spirit? I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Christian Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting. Amen. Congregation, please be seated. Carter, you have made a public profession of your Christian faith. On behalf of this congregation, I now ask you, will you regularly gather among God's people in worship to receive God's word and share in his Holy Supper? Will you be a witness to the faith that has been given to you and strive to remain steadfast in God's word? Will you be a servant to others and seek to love your neighbors, following in the footsteps of our Lord Jesus? Will you proclaim the good news of Jesus Christ and his lordship in your life through your daily words and deeds? If so, please say, I will, and I ask God to help and guide me. Jacob, you have made a public profession of your Christian faith. On behalf of this congregation, I now ask you, will you regularly gather among God's people in worship to receive God's word and share in his Holy Supper? Will you be a witness to the faith that has been given to you and strive to remain steadfast in God's word? Will you be a servant to others and seek to love your neighbors, following in the footsteps of our Lord Jesus? Will you proclaim the good news of Jesus Christ and his lordship in your life through your daily words and deeds? If so, please say, I will, and I ask God to help and guide me.
I will, and I ask God to help and guide me.
People of God, do you promise to support these fellow Christians and pray for them in their life in Christ? Let us pray. Gracious Lord, through water and the Spirit, you have made these young men your own. You forgave them all their sins and brought them to newness of life. Continue to strengthen them with the Holy Spirit and daily increase in them your gifts of grace, the spirit of wisdom and understanding, the spirit of counsel and might, the spirit of knowledge and the fear of the Lord, the spirit of joy in your presence. Through Jesus Christ, your Son, our Lord. Amen. I would invite you to kneel and your parents to come forward at this time. Place your hands on your son's shoulders. Carter, Philippians 4:13. I can do all things through him who strengthens me. Father in heaven, for the sake of Jesus, stir up in Carter the gift of your Holy Spirit. Confirm his faith, guide his life, empower him in his serving, give him patience in suffering, and bring him to everlasting life. Amen. Jacob, Romans 1:16. For I am not ashamed of the gospel. It is the power of God for salvation to everyone who has faith. Father in heaven, for the sake of Jesus, stir up in Jacob the gift of your Holy Spirit. Confirm his faith, guide his life, empower him in his serving, give him patience in suffering, and bring him to everlasting life. Amen. All right, you can stand up. I have for each of you a certificate of confirmation and a hand cross that is a gift of the congregation. They're made to fit in your hand, and they can be a good thing to keep in your pocket or keep in your car or just have with you and to hold when you pray or when you're maybe sick or have trouble. It's just a thing to remember that you're holding on to Jesus, and that's what gets us through. All right? There you go. You can go back and sit down. You're welcome. Please stand as you are able. Let us pray for the church, the world, and all those in need. Heavenly Father, today we celebrate the saints that you have made through the death and resurrection of Jesus. We thank you that through our baptism into your death and resurrection, we are all made saints and will one day worship you eternally in heaven with all those we love who have gone before us. Today, we especially remember all those whom we love, those who are members of this congregation who have passed away within the last year, and all those who are special to us. We remember Robert Heil, Dolores Keenan, Mertis Alber, and Lois Molman. Sustain us in our faith so that one day we may see those we love again and worship eternally with them in heaven. Lord, in your mercy. Heavenly Father, we lift up these young people who have confirmed their faith and reaffirmed their baptismal vows this morning. We pray that your blessing would ever be on them and that you would carry them through any difficulty of life, as well as the good times, that you would be with them in joy and in sorrow. Lord, in your mercy. Father, we lift up all young people. We lift up those for whom we pray every day, our beloved children and grandchildren and great-grandchildren, nieces and nephews, the young ones of this congregation. Let them feel surrounded and upheld by a cloud of prayer every day as they go out into the world. Lord, in your mercy. Father, we pray for parents and grandparents and all those whose lives are given to caring for the young people of the community. Lord, we lift them up in times that are difficult and challenging, and we pray your blessing on them. We pray that you would give them wisdom and patience and everything they need. Lord, in your mercy. Father, we pray for your church on earth. We pray for this congregation and all the churches of this community, and for your church throughout the world. We especially lift up those who are persecuted for the sake of the faith. We ask that you would give them strength and courage and blessing beyond measure. Lord, in your mercy. Father, we pray for our nation. We pray that you would be present and that your will would be done in this election, that you would raise up leaders who are dedicated and faithful and who have integrity and who will work for the benefit of all. Lord, in your mercy. Father, we lift up those who are suffering right now from the COVID virus, those who are recovering, those who are in the hospital, those who are near death. We pray you would be with healthcare workers and all essential workers as they continue to do their work in the face of extreme challenges. We pray that in your goodwill, you would put an end to this pandemic and that you would be present in this circumstance as you are in all. Lord, in your mercy. We pray for those who are suffering from any other illness or trouble. We pray for those going through cancer treatments, those recovering from surgery, those who are lonely or ill or isolated, who have any need, maybe needs known only to you. We pray that we would be your voice and your hands and feet of comfort in this world. We especially lift up Amy Sue, Scott, Artis, Bob, Darlene, Tana, Chuck, Colleen, Roland, Kyson, Wilma, Luella, and all others whom we name before you in our hearts. Lord, in your mercy. Into your hands, loving and gracious Father, we commend all for whom we pray, trusting in your mercy, through the name of your Son, our Savior, Jesus Christ. Amen. The peace of the Lord be with you always. Please be seated. Our time of special music is a time of prayer and meditation as we prepare our hearts to receive the Lord in Holy Communion. Please stand as you are able. The Lord be with you. Lift up your hearts. Let us give thanks to the Lord our God. It is indeed right and salutary, our duty and our joy, that we should at all times and in all places give thanks and praise to you, Almighty and merciful God, through our Savior Jesus Christ. By the witness of the saints, you show us the hope of our calling and strengthen us to run the race set before us, that we may delight in your mercy and rejoice with them in glory. And so with all the saints, with the choirs of angels and the hosts of heaven, we praise your name and join their unending hymn. Blessed are you, Lord of heaven and earth. In mercy for our fallen world, you gave your only Son, that all those who believe in him should not perish, but have eternal life. We give thanks to you for the salvation you have prepared for us through Jesus Christ. Send now your Holy Spirit into our hearts, that we may receive our Lord with a living faith as he comes to us in his Holy Supper. Amen. Come, Lord Jesus. In the night in which he was betrayed, our Lord Jesus took bread and gave thanks, broke it and gave it to his disciples, saying, "Take and eat. This is my body given for you. Do this for the remembrance of me." Again, after supper, he took the cup, gave thanks, and gave it for all to drink, saying, "This cup is the new covenant in my blood, shed for you and for all people for the forgiveness of sins. Do this for the remembrance of me." Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come. Thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom and the power and the glory forever and ever. Amen. Please be seated. I would invite you to take out your communion kit and take the bread in your hand. The body of Christ given for you. the blood of Christ shed for you. And now may the body and blood of our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ strengthen you and keep you in true faith unto life everlasting. Go in his peace. Amen. Let us pray. Pour out upon us the spirit of your love, O Lord, and unite the wills of those whom you have fed with one heavenly food. Through Jesus Christ, our Lord. Amen. And now may the Lord bless you and keep you. The Lord's face shine on you with grace and mercy. The Lord look upon you with favor and give you peace. Amen. Our closing hymn is Earth and All Stars, which is number 731 in your red hymnal. Go in peace, serve the Lord.